Welcome back to the All Right Talk Show. And joining me this week is a coach, Forex trader and property investor, Lewis Crompton. Lewis, thanks for coming on the show. How are you doing?
Busy, tired out, lots going on with moving house.
Moving house, yeah. Big task.
Can't complain. Really big task, especially when you're moving into a project. But yeah, can't complain too much.
Love it. Well, let's bring it back to basics then. So tell us a bit about yourself and your background.
Sure. So my name is Lewis. I am unfortunately 31 years old. I have been trading is my main thing. So I'll talk about that first. I've been trading now Forex, commodities, stocks and shares and indexes for just over 6 years. I was trained by a company called Rich Dad Education, so Robert Kiyosaki's brand, if people have ever heard of him. And after about 7 months of being on their training, I left my job, started trading full time. And then the reason I did that was to travel the world. So basically started traveling the world. And then after trading full time for about a year, Rich Dad Education asked me to come back and do some teaching and some coaching for them. So I said yes, carried on traveling, teaching in different parts of the world. So all over the place, South America, South Africa, Canada, North America, various parts of Europe, Hong Kong, Singapore, all over the place. I had an amazing time doing that. But then just got frustrated with how much that particular company would charge for their training. I mean, I paid about £10,000 upwards for my education. And I did such a good job of showing people what was possible with trading, but then couldn't necessarily give them access to the level of education they needed to make it a success. That I just started to get frustrated. So I decided to create my own thing. It took me about 2 years to create it and launch it. Launched at the back end of last year. And yeah, it's been going really, really well. People are getting results, which is the key thing. And so that's kind of like my Forex world and life and coaching. But then with the money I was making through trading, I decided to start investing in property. So that's how I got involved in property, met a lot of property investors, used angel investment, end up with around £500,000 worth of angel investment, which I'm now in the process of paying everyone back because I don't like using angel investment anymore. Find it stressful, find it a hassle. I just can't be bothered with that. So I've been paying everyone back. And I should hopefully have paid everyone back by the end of, halfway through this year is the goal. Because just timing of deals and stuff like that. And then what else do I do? Small business coaching, life coaching, although I hate the term life coaching. I find it so weak and so naff as a term. I focus on three things: accountability, support, and empowerment. In my, that's kind of my coaching style. And it's something I bring into everything that I do, whether that's trading, property, small business, whatever it is. Wow. So, yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Where do we start with this? Like you seem to be like a jack of all trades here. Like, as I said, you've traveled the world, which is sure is like many people's dream is to like work and travel. That's absolutely amazing. So what got you into the teaching? And so as you said, you worked for the Rich Dad Poor Dad company and they approached you after you going and doing their training. So why did you do their training? Was that what made you take that step and choose them?
Yeah. So, friends of mine had been on a course, actually a property one, and I decided to go on a property course as well and get involved with I'd always been interested in investments, just never knew how to go about it. So when they said they'd done this course and it was really good and they were taking action on it and all of that, I was like, okay, cool, I'll give it a go. So I signed up for a free seminar. We've all been to one of those, and it was a sales pitch. But when I actually turned up to the seminar for property, they said, your name's not on the list, Lewis. I was like, oh, that's strange. I signed up for this like 3-4 days ago. Are you sure? Yeah, we're sure. Give us a second though. So then they gave him a second and they came back and said, right, we found your name. It's on a different list, but you've actually signed up for the trading seminar, not the property seminar. So, all right. Okay. So I was like, in for a penny, in for a pound. I've always had an interest in that as well since being a kid. I actually begged my dad when I was about 13 to open up a trading account for me, but he needed about 15 grand and wasn't willing to risk that on a 13-year-old. So that never happened. But he didn't know you can actually start with like £300. I just went into that, was completely sold by the 2-hour sales pitch, was like, yep, let's do this. Went on to a course, which was about, I think, either £500 or £1,000 for the weekend. So I did that for the weekend, which was just a sales pitch, to a 9-month course, which is what cost me around 10 grand. And I took out a personal loan, cost me 15.5% per year, which if I knew anything about money back then like I do now, I'd never have taken that loan out, but you don't know what you don't know. and I can't regret it because it got me to where I am today. So yeah, so that's kind of how that happened. Why I end up teaching for them, I'd made a success of their training, so it's always good to have people that have been through your course, I suppose, talking about it and sharing information about it when they've made a success of it. And I've always been teaching. I've always been coaching since the age of about 13, 14. I mean, it's in my blood. Both my parents are teachers. Yeah. My mum was a primary school teacher. My dad was a secondary school teacher. Not maths or anything like that. People always think, oh, you must be really good at maths if you're a trader. And that's like, no, I'm horrendous at mental arithmetic. I use a calculator for everything. And all my trades, I use a spreadsheet, which I've created to make sure that I'm doing things correctly and make sure my students are doing stuff correctly as well, because the majority of us are not great at maths.
Yeah.
So teaching's always been in my blood. So I've always wanted to give back in some capacity whenever I've found value in something. So yeah, that's kind of where that came from.
Yeah. That's awesome. And so yeah, it's funny how you ended up doing trading over property, but now you're kind of doing both, aren't you? So yeah, with your property then, because you're doing very well with your Forex, I take it, because obviously you're mentoring people in the Forex world now. And with property, is that when you started to become profitable in Forex? Is that when you was like, okay, now that I've got a bit of capital, I'm going to invest that in property? And was that just buy to let strategy?
So I think I'm always very careful to share the reality of life and investing and the journey of trading. So yes, I use trading money to invest in property, but it's not the sole thing that I used. Mm. I also use angel investment, like I mentioned before, mm-hmm. and that's really how I got started. But yes, I have and do use trading profits for property, but it's not my sole thing that I use to purchase property in terms of it as a cash source. In terms of when I started, it was buy to lets. Then I did HMOs. Multi-lets, then HMOs. Then I did a flat conversion, just turning a property into a couple of flats. It was actually a terrible idea. Wouldn't recommend doing that. Doesn't actually add any value to the property whatsoever. And then I did a flip. Well, I'm in the process of doing a flip at the moment. Also don't like flips, so I'll never do one of them again. Well, never say never, but I'm not particularly interested in doing one of those again. And yeah, for me now, it's all about buy to let, seeing what I'm interested in. I do social housing. That's my favorite strategy, social housing.
Is that because the rent's guaranteed with social, and it's, yeah. Is it more hands off in terms of, you it's don't more have to deal with letting agents?
Yeah, it's more hands off. You know what's going to happen each month. You know what your figures are. I'm happy to take a hit on the ROI. I've got enough other stuff going on which generates me cash. For me, property is a long-term investment strategy. I mean, I'm in the process of moving all my portfolio to capital repayment because it's lower risk. Mm. Every single month, I like the idea of buying back a little bit of capital. I know all the arguments as to why you should pay interest only. I don't care about those arguments. For me, I have a business and I have my own trading. I have multiple streams of income which generate me the cash to then invest into property. That property doesn't have to be my cash flow. I don't have to live off my property income. It's just to reinvest. So I'd rather, with property, play it safer, play it easier, have less time commitment in that particular strategy. And that's what I'm using property for, really.
Yeah, and then less debt essentially as well down the long run. Yeah, because, you know, as you said, some people would argue against that, but there is other people that are on your side that they prefer to pay off the debt on the properties they own. And then once they do reach retirement age, they own pretty much everything then. And I'm guessing that's what you want to do.
Just lowering my risk, lowering my exposure bit by bit. That's what I want to do.
Yeah, exactly.
So that's... And again, I know the arguments, and this, I think the longer I've been involved in investments and the more people I've coached, it's you really have to find, yes, okay, step out of your comfort zone, all of that stuff, but you really have to find what you're comfortable with and what you actually want. Mm-hmm. And this is something I spend a lot of time doing with my coaching clients, is right, what's actually going to make you happy? Is being a multi-billionaire and working your ass off and sacrificing your relationships and your joy and all of that in order to get that, is that really what you want? 99% of the time, people don't want as much as they say they want when they first are talking about investments. They're actually happier with a lot less, and the less, which also generates less stress if they do it correctly. That's what more people want. So I'm not really a coach that is going to tell you to 10x your life. I think that whole stuff is bullshit. I think it's pathetic.
I agree.
I'm gonna rephrase that, because I don't think it's pathetic for certain people. I think there is a very small proportion of the population that works for, but it is a small proportion. For the rest of the population who try to buy into that, but it doesn't actually sit congruent with who they are, they buy into this ethos of 10x, and actually it just damages them and damages their life, like puts extra pressure on them, and actually is not a way to live a happy life at all. So I always say, you want to 10x your results? Brilliant. 10x your problems then. Are you happy to 10x your problems? Probably not. So let's really question if you want to 10x that.
That's an interesting way to look at it, actually. And I've never thought about that. And touching on that 10x rule from that certain individual that, I don't know if that person invented it, but at the start of this month, I chose that book as my Audible book. Uh-huh. And I, within the first 24 hours, I sent it back and got a different one, just because I was like, this is, I mean, obviously it works for him, but I didn't like it. I just didn't like the way I was being told what was what and told what was true. And he was like, yeah, all these people that enjoy the journey, that's a load of nonsense. I was like, who are you to tell people that they can't enjoy their journey? Like, yeah. I was like, nah, getting a refund, mate.
Yeah. So what, you're going to tell people not to enjoy their journey? So they're not meant to find happiness and joy in what they're doing?
Yeah.
I just can't get on board with that.
Same.
American ego-driven bullshit. Mm. No.
Yeah.
It's all ego-driven. And all these people that I see online, like, spouting about confidence this and be your best self. Like, I just look at them and I just see insecurity. And I just hear insecurity in what they say. It's so incongruent to me. And don't get me wrong, I've hardly got everything nailed down and sorted. I make mistakes every flipping day. And I get my priorities wrong. And I'm definitely no saint to a perfect thing. But what I will refuse to do is pile onto other people a certain way of behaving and expectations which they don't even want for themselves. And again, I probably even get that wrong sometimes. But when I catch myself, I will stop doing that.
And I think people buy into that more, Lewis, to be honest. Like that whole thing, like your ethos, it's like just being transparent, isn't it? And being honest with yourself at the end of the day, isn't it?
Yeah. And I had an event at the start of the year, which was a bit of like a goal planning event. It had some really great speakers come along. And I say that because I'm not trying to sell it. The tickets have gone. It's happened. Like, the event's already been and gone. But it was one of the things I did was I had people take stock of where they were at and just be honest. And that honest factor of, right, where actually am I? And right. And then they say, right, what I want from this year. Cool. And then a very simple question, is that really what you want? And the amount of people that actually struggled with that question was quite surprising, because we think we're sitting back to reflect and pause and set goals for what we want for the year, but we often fail to actually ask ourselves the question, is that actually what I want? Where is that coming from? Like, why do I want to have 10 properties generating X amount of money by the end of the year? Do I really want that? Have I really thought through what that's going to mean and what impact that's going to have? Because every decision has benefit and every decision has cost. So do you want the benefit enough to put up with the cost? And if the answer is yes to that, and you're honest about what that cost actually is, then great, fantastic, go for it. But you're going to create a whole world of misery for yourself. And in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years time, you will wake up and think, I've created my own living hell. Mm. And I've seen that happen too many times. And that's when people end up talking to me, and I help them get out of that situation in various ways, in various capacities.
I totally agree. And something that I learned probably last year, actually, like, this is before I even started networking with people in property, etc., was knowing, like, when I used to say, like, oh, I would love to have 50 properties, and then someone said to me one day, why do you want 50? Why? But what's your reason? And I couldn't answer him. And
it
really got me thinking. And then I listened to a podcast with like an investor, and he was like saying, you know, if you work out what you actually would want. So let's say, for instance, some people say, well, I want £1 million because they think that's what make them happy. But actually, you could live off a lot less and still be happy. So, for instance, like, I, you know, I looked on Rightmove at a house that, you know, a nice house that I'd like to live in. Turns out it's, you know, it was about £350,000, and the mortgage payments on that was about, you know, £800 a month or something like that. And then, like, my dream car was a Ford Mustang, so I worked out the payments.
Oh, lovely.
Yeah, you know, I love Mustangs. I'd like, yeah, I think that was like £500 a month, including insurance on a lease. Mm-hmm. And then I worked out, like, you know, I wanted to get myself a PT, and then some buffer money, some investing money. It worked out all I needed to be financially free, as you'd call it, and to be like happy with the things that I want would be like £4,000 a month. Mm-hmm. And I know that is a lot of money, don't get me wrong, to a lot of people, but like, it's not £1 million a year, or it's not a millionaire. And that's like, I think four grand a month, I could live off that for the rest of my life.
Yeah.
You know, and it's not, you know, people look, £4 grand a month, like, and then people talk about 10x in themselves, like 25-50k a month. I was like, okay, but that's a lot of money. That's great, having, that's more freedom for you to, like, maybe if you want to buy a yacht or something, but you don't actually need that to live, do you?
No, exactly.
It's just interesting to find that out. So I'm guessing when it comes back to the coaching, when you coach people, do you find that people change the way they think when you ask them that question then?
Definitely, yeah, definitely. And also changes the way they're going to make that money as well, if that makes sense. Because we think that there's a particular way that we should do that and create that. But yeah, and it's a tricky question to answer because every client is different. Every person I coach is different. And there's some people who are such driven personalities. That's their nature, that they do want to just keep growing. And they are never satisfied with a particular amount. So then we work on that a little bit. But I don't really want to work on that because that is their nature. And they will always be wanting more. But it's, again, then I always have them question, what's the expense? So what offer, I tend to work with people that are quite family orientated. I don't know why, that just tends to be what happens. And so there's often people who are very, very driven, but they have families and they want to spend more time with their family. But then I point out to them that their driven nature is taken, and they often wrap up their driven nature in the fact they want to create more time and more money for their family. It's like, okay, great. So you want to create more time for your family, but you've spent about an hour this past 2 weeks with your family because you're so driven trying to achieve something, which ultimately is to give you more time with your family, when you could actually just spend more time with your family now, which would be achieving that goal and still be building your business, just maybe slightly slower, but enjoying where you're at with the actual ultimate goal anyway, which is spending time with your family. And that's often a, oh shit, moment for them.
Yes.
And again, it's balance is a lie. That's something which I picked up on very, very early on. Balance is a lie. We never will achieve balance. We are always on a pendulum.
Yeah, thank God you said that.
But it's true. Like, there's trying to find a middle ground is not going to happen. So one of the things that I do with clients is I have them, and I'm talking way more about coaching stuff than Forex stuff here, but anyway, what I have them do when I'm working one-on-one with them is say, right, what, and I did this at the event as well. I said, right, you have these number of areas, whatever the main areas are in your life, they tend to be around 5-6 areas of your life. What are you actually going to focus on month by month? And you can only pick 2 to focus on each month, because you can't focus on 5 things in every single month. You can't give all your energy and your attention to 5 things. It doesn't work. So something has to take a back seat to make proper progress in a different area. So either you have one focus which you maintain the whole way through the year, and then you have different ones that change as you're going through. But you have to be very aware that if you're trying to drive a business or 2 businesses, that's their separate focuses. Each business is a separate focus. So then where's the family dynamic as a focus?
Yeah,
it's not going to be a focus. So family time is going to take a hit that month. Doesn't mean you completely ignore your family or you completely ignore other business interests. It just means your focus and your growth that you're pouring your energy into is not in that other area at that time. So balance is a lie. You cannot achieve balance if you're trying to grow different things in your life.
Because that's something that, if I'm honest, I struggle with. I always like, well, I need this balance, and I'm always like trying to, it's like a juggling act and like spinning plates, as you will. And it's like, well, I do make sure that I spend a few hours at night time with my family, mm-hmm. and then, you know, I allocate some time for the weekend. And I always say to them, you know, if I've got to like work over or whatever, or work on whatever I'm doing, editing the podcast or whatever, I'll always say I'm working hard now, so I don't have to, you know, 10, 15 years down the line. But at the same time, there's no guarantee what will happen in the future. Well, there kind of is if you work hard at something, you know, compound your time and whatever. But again, it's like, what do you do? Like, I think that is, it is a good approach, what you said, where you spend more time with your family now, and maybe your business, it takes a little bit longer. But yeah, but some people would, maybe not disagree with that, but kind of like doing it their way, where, well, kind of what I said, like they spend a little less time with their family, so they work harder now, so they can then retire at the age of 40, maybe 50, and then spend even more time and go, you know, go traveling the world together or whatever. But yeah, I like your approach.
Yeah, I think the I want to retire at 40 is very short-sighted. And I used to say it, but I think it's so short-sighted. Okay, great. So say, I mean, friends of mine got married super early. So my friends had kids at the age of 21. So their kid is going to be 19 when they reach 40. So you're going to miss out on 19 years of your kid growing up, their formative years, so that you can then retire at 40, and then you can spend all the time in the world with them. Doesn't really make sense. If you actually think about it, it's completely logical. And then what do you mean retire? You mean you're going to stop working? You mean you're not going to be doing anything for the rest of your life after 40, and you may live at least another 40 years. So then you're going to do bugger all with your life for 40 years. You're taking the piss. Like you're deluding yourself. Like what is you're actually going to do with your time? Oh, I want to travel the world. I've done it. I traveled the world for 3 years. Believe me, it gets boring, and that is painful, because you love traveling. You love the experience of it. But what are you missing out on? Friends, family, connection, community, being present in a space, and creating a root network of relationships. You don't have any of that. Okay, I'm going to travel with my family. What if they want to go somewhere different to you? What if they don't want to travel? What if you've got kids and then they have to go to school? What if they decide to go to university? It's actually a very selfish way to think, and it's normally a decision made by single people who say that. Like, there's a lot of couples who will say they're going to do that, and they do it before they have kids, but they create remote working. They don't stop working. They create remote working, whether that's trading Forex or a remote property business, whatever it is. Or they're just IT people, because IT people and graphic designers, they can do a similar thing too, because all they need is a computer. Then they do that. And then guess what they do when they have kids? They stop traveling.
I always tell people, because I've done traveling myself. I did 3 years of it with my partner, and I always say, like, don't settle down too early. Get your traveling out the way, because you know, your life will take over. It inevitably will. So that's what I did. I saved up a lot of money, and I blew it all on traveling. And I worked whilst I was traveling. I didn't blow it all. That sounds silly, blowing it all. But what I mean by blowing it all, I had the best experiences of my whole life throughout the course of 3 years. So I do agree on that. And I think with the road retirement, for me, retirement means I get to choose whether to work or not. And I think for me, I'll be working till I'm dead, probably, because my mind has to keep busy. I think the people that say are going to retire at 40, but they actually mean that they don't want to work. They won't retire till they're 70, most likely.
Yeah,
those types. Yeah.
Exactly. I mean, like, technically with my property stuff, even if I decide not to trade, I've got enough money to live off of just from the property portfolio.
Yeah.
Now, it's not the type of lifestyle that I want, but it's a lifestyle and would pay me an average salary. And that's still going to keep growing. So in one sense, I can retire. Am I going to? No. I think I'm similar to you. My brain needs something to do, which I've realized over the past 6 months, and my partner's been pointing out, I'm a bit of a workaholic. I'm not very good at sitting still. Agreed. And that isn't healthy either. And that's something I'm really trying to work on. And the thing is I work quite smart as well as working hard. So I get a lot done in quite a short period of time compared to other people, because I've just got systems for a lot of stuff that I do. So I get away with it. But it's still a lot. And so I'm in 2021. I've made a commitment to take weekends off, I say weekends. I'll still work until about 12 o'clock on either the Saturday or the Sunday. and then I'll have the rest of the weekend off.
Yeah, no, that's good, and it's good that you've decided to do that, and create more just time for yourself, just a switch off time, I'll call it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, nice, yeah. Cool. So yeah, let's moving on then. Great talk so far, by the way. Moving on, do you want to talk a bit more about your Forex thing? I'm sure people, that's what you promote a lot. So yeah, let's talk about your Forex and what you want to talk about that.
Sure. So I think one of the things I'm very keen to do when it comes to Forex is to not flash Lamborghinis and Rolex watches. We've all seen those dickheads, I'm just going to say it, on Instagram and on Facebook, and all these ridiculous adverts, which are just, they piss me off. The community that I've created, my company's called Star Trading, and the community that we've got in Star Trading is just, we take screenshots of these adverts and record them on our phones and send them into our little group chat. It's quite funny, and they are just insane. And now that people who've come through my training have been through the training, they actually understand what it's really about. They can see all the bullshit out there. It's quite funny. So yeah, I think one thing that I talk about a lot with trading is, again, what is the reality? What can you actually achieve? How much time? That's always a question. How much time does it take? If you want to be a swing trader, which is like a medium term style of trading, it's different to a day trader. A day trader is like your stereotypical, I'm going to sit at my screen for every single hour of the day, up in the middle of the night trading. That's the stereotypical idea of a day trader. A day trader doesn't actually need that much time, but they do need more time than a swing trader. What I tend to do is teach people, primarily other investors, actually, in terms of property investors. But I've got people of all walks of life on my training. I teach them how to trade swing-based trading strategies, which are based upon patterns in the market, which we've analyzed and tested systematically through a minimum of 3 years across multiple markets, and using multiple timeframe analysis as well to ensure that they are working correctly and continue to work. Mm-hmm. And so we have data that we create on every single strategy that we have. On the training, I teach four different strategies, and also teach people how to create them for themselves. I'm never going to be a Forex network marketer. I'm actually fine with network marketing, but not when it comes to Forex, because it encourages people to overtrade. They charge you a fee to be part of the community, which is extortionate compared to what you actually need. it's encourages overtrading. There's just so much that's wrong with it. So my whole training is designed to make people independent, make people not need me. So yes, I'm doing myself out of a job, but I'm fine with that. And my job is to make people trade better than I trade. And that happens. So I get people trading live within 6 months, being profitable traders, consistent traders, safe traders. So people never risk more than 1% to 2% of their account on a trade. So if you have a £100 account, you're only ever risking £1 or £2. I had to go simple numbers there because my mental arithmetic. And in terms of returns that are expected, I say within your first 6 months, you should be aiming for 2% per month. Anyone who understands numbers knows that's actually incredible, but that's actually very, very achievable through trading. Then we work up to 5% per month, and then we work up beyond there as well. But people beat those timeframes that I set them because I try to be as realistic as possible. I mean, Ian, one of the guys in our community, he's a property investor as well, also has a business, wanted to trade alongside that, only using 30 minutes a day. His first month trading live, after I think he'd been learning with me for about 5 months, he made 8% return in 1 month.
Is that, I was going to say, that sounds like a pretty good return as well.
Yeah, it's a really good return. And this, again, the reality with trading is, you have to, 1 month does not a trader make, is the reality. So you have to look at what is kind of your performance over a longer period of time. But if over a year you average at 2% per month, that means you've made for the year 24% non-compounded. If you compound it, it's about 27%. If you're making 5%, then again, you're making really, really good money. And if you're based in the UK, then 99% of the time, that's a tax-free income for you as well, which is brilliant.
Is that up to a certain amount?
Nope, any amount.
So, okay, that's interesting. I didn't know that. So why, Do you know the reason why it's not? So you could, let's say, for instance, you could,
I hope I know the reason, considering I teach people.
I was going to say, so you could earn that, like, you know, let's say, for instance, so scenario, stocks and shares ISA is £20,000 tax-free. So Forex, you could earn 30, 40, 50, 60,000 pounds, and that's tax-free.
Yeah.
Why is that?
The only reason it is that way is if you're in the UK. So, I mean, for example, my students got various sums of money. People I've coached have got $500,000. People I've coached have got 500. So we always talk about percentages, first of all. We level the playing field because performance is technically the same if you're basing it on percentages. So the reason it's tax-free is because in the UK, you can open up with a broker called a spread betting broker. A spread betting broker is classified by the UK government. No other government in the world, just the UK government, as being a gambling vehicle rather than an actual trading vehicle, an investment vehicle. So because of that, it makes it tax-free.
That's what I was going to say. The only way I could think of it being tax-free, obviously, if it was considered gambling. And I suppose it is, in a way, a form of gambling. But obviously, if you know what you're doing, like yourself, you can make money and be very profitable.
Yeah, so I always say it's not a form of gambling. It's only a form of gambling in the same way that setting up a business is gambling. Mm. It's only a form of gambling in the same sense of buying any stock or share is gambling as well. We know that investments go up. We know that investments go down. But if you know what you're doing, it's a calculated risk, which is different to a gamble, technically.
Yes. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I agree. No, that's amazing. So with your, how many students do you currently have in your program then, and that are doing well? Is there any that haven't done well, or is that due to their mindset? Because I know mindset must play a big thing, because you are gambling with money. And what I've never traded Forex. I've practiced with it, but my emotion's not in it. And that's why I've spoke to Forex traders before, and they've always said, if you're practicing, it's not going to be the real thing, because it's the emotion is not in it of losing money.
Yeah. So I did every Tuesday in my Facebook group for Star Trading, I do a live training, like just a quick one. And this week's one was on demo trading, so practice trading. And yeah, I only recommend demo trading for really a couple of weeks, because you get used to that broker's system, but it's not real money. You want to be trading with real money relatively quickly, but still with a skill set in place and a basic understanding. So back to your question, in terms of have I got students on my course who haven't been successful? Of course I do. Is there students in schools that don't get A-levels or GCSEs? Of course there is. Mm-hmm. You can create a whole environment. You can create a whole system which other people can use to be successful. Doesn't mean everybody will. You can lead a horse to water. Doesn't mean that they'll drink. Yeah. So yes, the mindset question is, for me, kind of a different question to that. Part of the ongoing coaching we do is to help people manage their mindset and get their mindset into the right place. So there is that component, and certain people do find trading more difficult, but that doesn't mean that it's going to be impossible for them. Trading for me is not a natural skill. It's something which I've mastered and chosen to master and put my time and energy and to master and get good at it. So that's what I did.
Yes. Well, 6 years is a long time to do it. So, you know, it just goes to show, if you practice something long enough, you can become the master of it. And I'm sure already it was like the 10,000 hour rule, which equates to 4 hours a day for 7 years. Don't question my maths on that one. But I'm sure like after 7 years, if you spend that long on something, you become a master of it. And obviously, clearly you're very good at what you do.
I did a podcast last year, and they said, you have to be trading for at least 5 years before you can consider yourself a true trader. I was like, oh well, that's good, I can tick that box then. And I hadn't personally heard that before, but it's quite nice. I mean, it's probably bullshit, isn't it, really? But I do think the longer you've been in the game, the more credibility you've got, but you've been around the block, you've experienced most of what there is to experience. But it's not just that I've been trading myself for over 6 years, is that for the past 4 years I've been teaching other people how to trade as well. So that's a whole different skill set, and there's plenty of people who can trade but can't teach other people how to do it. there's plenty of people who could teach other people how to trade on a technical level, but can't actually trade themselves. It is kind of rare to find somebody that can do both and do both well.
So who was your first mentee then? Like, did someone approach you and say, like, Lewis, like, you do Forex, I can see you've been doing pretty well. Can you train me? And then did you do that first person for free, or did you know you could train them up? So like how did that come about, the training for the Forex?
So because I was doing it for Rich Dad originally.
So
that's kind of where it started in that capacity. I always had friends ask me to teach them as well, but didn't want to pay me any money, and I value my time. So
yeah, absolutely.
I don't do that. I don't do that.
Full stop.
I say I don't do that. Yeah. No, it sounded very full stop, wasn't it? But it isn't. Like, people who I've got true relationship with and have done for years, I'll do some free stuff with them, but only to a point, because it comes to a point where either you're going to invest in yourself, I'm not going to keep investing my time into you unless you take the next step. And at which point, if you want to give me money, great. That's fantastic. I'll teach you how to do that. I'll take it to the next level with you. But I'm not going to invest my time and energy into people that won't invest in themselves. I've done far too much of that in the past, and it doesn't really get you anywhere. I used to do counseling when I was younger. That's a kind of a whole different story. So it's in my nature to give back and to help and to help people make positive change and transformation in their lives. So when I was doing counseling, I trained with an organization in the US, and it was paid for counseling, but I did loads of pro bono. But I could tell you so many stories of people who pay for it. They value the time. They get the most out of their time with you. People who you do pro bono stuff for don't value it. They're less likely to turn up. They're less likely to be engaged with the session. There is something when you put your money where your mouth is and say, I want to actually do this, and you invest in that decision with a monetary value, that you make it happen, and you make the most of that time. Now, don't get me wrong, there's people who've dropped thousands upon thousands upon thousands of pounds on training. I don't charge that much. But there's people who spent a lot of money on training when I was with Rich Dad and did absolutely nothing with it. And that's always baffled me. But that's some people's nature. So if anybody would like to drop £10,000 and want nothing in return, then I'm here.
Well, likewise. No, you're absolutely right. And I think, as you said, if people pay for something, they value it a lot more than if it's handed to them on a plate. It's kind of like, oh, well, I'll get to that. You know, it's 100% right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So just let's quickly go back to the coaching as well, because I wanted to talk. You said to me before the start of this show that you coach people who have experienced trauma. So how does that come into the coaching then? Do these people approach you, or how does that work?
Well, everybody I coach, I'm aware of trauma in some capacity. But yes, so I used to do a lot more of this a couple of years ago. Have done less of it because it's not necessarily a natural crossover from financial Forex trader coaching to trauma coaching. But most people on the planet, whether they know it or not, have experienced trauma in some capacity. And all I mean by trauma is they have had a negative event happen in their life, which is, well, trauma is actually relatively hard to define. But the way I think about trauma is, have you ever, you know, when your body goes into fight or flight mode? Mm-hmm. So if we're thinking about the human body, your body is what holds trauma as an experience. It's also chemicals and everything, hormones and all the stuff connected to it, and then memories get associated to that and locked in with trauma too, but it's all held in your body. So when your body experiences that fight or flight reaction, but it can't actually activate either one of them, so you're pinned down by something, so you're freaked out, so you're frozen, so you're in fight or flight, you can't punch back for whatever reason, so you're basically paralyzed.
Yeah.
And you can't run away, so you can't escape it. Your body goes into this state, which is a trauma state, which is self-protection. And what often happens there is parts of your brain, your psyche, actually detach. And that doesn't happen to everybody, but it does happen to a lot of people in some capacity. So a lot of people who are fighting invisible barriers, like, oh, I just, for some reason, I can't take this step, I can't take this action, it's actually, that is a defense mechanism that the body is experiencing because of trauma. So that trauma gets linked with so many different experiences in life, I mean, very, very common ones are like people who have a real difficulty launching a business. It's because actually that business requires something of them, which triggers a trauma response, because it may be they have to be more present on social media, and being more present on social media doesn't feel safe, and they don't know why it doesn't feel safe, but there's going to be something that's happened which is locked into their psyche and their physicality, their body, which causes them to have a negative response to being in the public eye or being seen or being noticed by people. So they will actually have an internal thing going on deep in their inner workings, inner world, which is trying to hold them back from the limelight so they never get seen or identified or noticed. So it's that kind of thing.
Wow, yeah, you know, that's a really detailed answer, and I love that. And you know what, something like what you've just said, I could talk about for hours and hours, so you know, we could even go into another episode with this, like a part two, but we are running out of time. But yeah, I love that you kind of, you see, that's like the trauma thing. I was different, because I always think the word trauma, you think like car crash or mm-hmm. Yeah, but I suppose it doesn't have to be like, you know, things like divorce or breakups, that can be considered as trauma as well, right?
Oh, so, definitely.
Yeah,
definitely. But well, I mean, a divorce is a perfect example of it, because you, I mean, I suppose in one sense you're flighting, you're running mm-hmm. from a situation,
yeah.
But you can't escape that. You can't escape that feeling. So really deep emotion is often actually a traumatic experience, because you can't escape that emotion. So what do you do? What do people do? They try and numb that pain. So what do? We stay busy. We overthink. Overthinking is actually an anxiety response, which is often linked to some form of trauma at some point in our lives. Mm. So, and I'm an overthinker. I've experienced trauma myself, and I know that part of my mechanism of coping over the past 31 years has been to overthink and overanalyze, because it keeps my brain thinking about surface level shite that doesn't really mean anything.
Yes.
Why am I thinking about this? It's not important. It's because your brain is trying to stay up here, so it doesn't have to deal with what's actually under here.
Yeah.
So when we go silent, when I'm having downtime, often my anxiety will increase. And that's why I try and stay on a subconscious level. I try and stay busy, because I don't want my anxiety to come up, because anxiety is pain. And it's an emotion that my body is trying to escape from. So it quietens down the anxiety noise by increasing this noise, although it's actually causing anxiety. It's really messed up. Although it's actually causing anxiety, it's a trauma response, and it's actually a defense mechanism, because it's all designed to stop me feeling pain. So another one, alcoholism. It's all designed to stop you feeling pain.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what you've just said, I really resonate with that as well, because just exactly what you've described, I've been through the exact same. So yeah, seems like we've been on a similar path in the past, but yeah, crazy. Excellent. So just moving on quickly then, plans for the future. What have you got planned in the next, let's call it the next 12 months. What's going on this year with you?
I'm going to 10X my life.
Love it.
Am I bollocks? Am I going to do that? No, not at all. Well, I'm simplifying this year. This year is a year of simplification for me. So I'm simplifying my property portfolio. I'm actually selling some property to buy social housing property in a different area. I'm shifting stuff over to capital repayments. I'm continuing with my coaching work, but I don't want to take on too many clients. I only want about 6 clients. I'm already at 4 because I've been downsizing. When it comes to coaching stuff, that is. I am going to keep growing Star Trading, which is my trading business, trader training business. I'm just going to continue doing what I've been doing for 6 years with my own trading. And I'm going to learn to rest and relax better and take more time off. So systemizing some stuff within my trading business, because that's it's only a year old really, so it's a fairly new business. And it's been amazing. And the students are phenomenal. The community is incredible. So I still want to grow that, and it's an exciting time, but everything else I'm kind of making a little bit more quiet.
Yeah. And then retire by 40. Yeah.
retire at 35. That's the plan. Yeah.
Love it, Lewis. Love it. All right. Cool. So have you got any advice for others? You could say either getting into Forex, and then you could say advice for others getting into property, because a lot of people that invest in property do listen to this show as well.
Mm-hmm. So if you even have a mild interest in Forex, avoid YouTube, avoid forums. There's so much shite and rubbish out there. It's not worth it. Avoid network marketing. Avoid options trading. That's bullshit. I'm going to do a post actually at some point on the 4 scams of Forex. But anyway, yeah, if what I would do, so in terms of what you should go towards rather than just avoid, is contact me on Instagram, Lewis, L-E-W-I-S underscore Crompton, C-R-O-M-P-T-O-N. I've got a free ebook, which is 50 pages long, which apparently is quite long for an ebook, but it's still an easy, enjoyable read. And you can download that through my Instagram profile. And that honestly is a really good place to start because it's a fairly honest take on Forex, shows what's possible. And gives you a bit of an idea. So if you have that itch to know more, I'd read that. That's going to tell you if you are actually interested or if it's just you just need to scratch that itch or not. So yeah, that's where I'd kind of start with Forex. And I know it's a bit of a shameless plug, but I also know it's a good read. So yeah,
you wrote it, of course.
Exactly. And then in terms of property, learn to do your numbers when it comes to property. Really think about how you're going to raise finance for it, whether that's through your own money or through angel investors, whatever that is. If you're going to use angel investors, figure out how you're actually going to pay them back. If you don't manage to find a money in, money out deal and you get a down valuation, how are you going to pay those people back? It's not necessarily as easy and simple as people make it out to be. And don't believe everything you hear on social media. Yeah. It's probably another one as well. So yeah, they're probably my top tips.
Lovely. Yeah, really appreciate them. Thank you for it. I'm sure they'll help out a lot of people that listen to this. Excellent. So brings us to the final part of our show now, which is a random question round. Just three questions, quick fire. All right, we'll just start off with number one, what's your favorite movie?
The Fifth Element.
Oh God, what a film.
What a film. It's fantastic. I love it. Yeah. Absolutely love that movie.
There's just the what's it called? New York or something? And it's like the flying taxis and...
Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah. I just love what New York... Is it set in New York, the start? It is,
I think it is, yeah. Yeah, with Bruce Willis. And then I for some reason, I love the opera section. And then she dies and he has to pull the stones outside of her stomach. Yeah, love it. Yeah,
it's brilliant. And what's his name in that? The guy that's in Rush Hour?
He
plays Rudy Rudd.
Which is a phenomenal character.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah.
It's an idiot. What's his name? I can't remember.
Chris Tucker.
That's it. Yeah.
Yeah. Classic movie. Yeah. Great pick. All right. Question two. This might be a difficult one for you. Favorite destination?
Ooh, favorite destination. I don't know. Cape Town.
Oh, I've never been. Is it good?
Yeah. Oh, it's incredible.
Yeah.
You've got beach, you've got mountains, you've got wine. I mean, it's fun. If you don't like wine, I wouldn't bother. But I mean, I would still bother. It's still beautiful. Yeah. But yeah, I love it.
Fantastic. Yeah. Well, I need to get myself out there after this COVID malarkey pisses off.
Yeah.
Yeah. And third and final question, name something that grinds your gears.
10X.
Yeah. Love it.
But I would say just general personal development bullshit that isn't actually helpful to anybody.
Yeah, and that's one of them is 10x, right?
Yeah, it really is.
Yeah, I think everyone wishes 5x instead of 10x. How about that one? You know,
yeah.
Soften the blow.
Cool. Soften the blow.
Yeah. Excellent. So, yeah, finally, and how can people get in touch with you?
Instagram is probably the thing I'm on the most. So it's just at Lewis underscore Crompton, L-E-W-I-S underscore C-R-O-M for Mike, P-T-O-N for November. Or you can email me at lewis@startradingnow.com. Those are the two best ways.
Excellent. Lewis, honestly, mate, you've been an incredible guest and thanks for sharing your journey with us so far. And yeah, if anyone wants to reach out to Lewis, then please get in touch. Yeah. Lewis, thanks for coming on.
Absolute pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, cheers. All right, this has been The Alright Talk Show. Thanks for listening again. We'll be back next week with another awesome guest. Ciao for now.